Hi, my name is Rick Edgeman. I'm professor and chair of the management department at Forte State University in the United States. I wear a couple of other hats. For example, I'm former professor of management practice and research director of the Shingo Institute, home of the Shingo Prize for Operational Excellence, where that is at Utah State University. I hold an ongoing appointment as professor of sustainability and enterprise performance at Aarhus University in Denmark, where formerly I was a tenured full professor before moving back to the United States in 2015. And additionally, I hold an honorary professor appointment of engineering operations management at the University of Southern Denmark. Today, however, I'm talking to you principally from the perspective of having been the research director at the Shingo Institute and in an ongoing role as Shingo Faculty Fellow, who administers for the most part the research award from the Shingo Institute. The question you're going to have today before you is, how is it that you build and assess enterprise excellence? Now, enterprise excellence is an interesting term. We defined it in the first of five presentations. This is the fifth. In between, we had three different presentations that dealt in depth with the principles and the model behind the Shingo Prize. The first one was a very large interview, or not interview, but overview of the Shingo Prize for Operational Excellence and its 10 supporting principles, behaviors, culture, and so on. So the Shingo model uses the term operational excellence, but equally there are terms that are used interchangeably for that. Enterprise excellence being one of those, performance excellence, business excellence, organizational excellence, so many names. Shingo Institute, operational excellence here, and I will tend to say enterprise excellence. There are some learning objectives that you should think about as you go through this particular presentation and video. Show how individual objectives help drive an organization itself, the organizational objectives. Answer the question, how do I influence leadership and get everybody on board if you're working within the organization but not necessarily from a position of leadership? Build on principles of enterprise excellence. Understand relationships among behavior systems principles and how they tend to drive results. Learn a little bit about KBIs, or key behavioral indicators, and how those drive, generally speaking anyway, KPIs, key performance indicators, and how this can help lead to excellent results. So many of you will be familiar with the term KPI, key performance indicators. Performance always results from behaviors, from actions. Therefore, we also need to know a little bit about key behavioral indicators, and those were covered much more extensively in one of the prior presentations, in particular in the presentation on enterprise enablers, or enablers of excellence. So we would look at those. And then lastly, it says use, go, and observe. We're not going to get to learning point six, or learning objective six. Go and observe. If you're familiar at all with Lean, then you will know that that is often called go to the Gemba. The Gemba is the place where work is actually done, and that's how we assess organizations, is we go to the places where the work is actually done to see how actual behaviors compare to what would be ideal behaviors, to see how actual systems compare to what ideal systems might look like, to see how actual results compare to what ideal results would be. So that's what we're looking to do, but we won't get to number six because that requires being on a floor at the business inside to see what's happening. So we're going to build piece by piece by piece in excellence. If you look at this triangle, we're going to build that out of 10 particular larger elements. So the first thing that we start with is organizational foundation and purpose. Why does the organization exist? What's it doing? And we're going to want to assess that. But we do that in terms of the Shingo model for operational excellence through principles. And there are 10 principles, again, of the Shingo model. So what is a principle? A principle is a foundational rule, or truth, if you will, that has an inevitable consequence. Principles are universal and timeless. Think about something like gravity. It applies all the time, everywhere you are, always. So it's something like gravity. And whether you believe in gravity or not, whether you understand gravity or not, you're subject to its consequences. If you step off a 10-story building, you are going to fall. And that is irrespective of any feelings, understanding, or belief in gravity that you may have. We say that principles are self-evident. Now, I don't want to be too flippant about this, because it doesn't mean that they are easily evident, but it does mean that we can't invent them. We can, however, uncover or discover the various principles through research, through study. So, I mean, here's a principle. It's an old adage. Many of you have heard this saying, what gets measured is what gets done. Why? Because, generally speaking, what gets measured tends to be also what people are either rewarded or punished for. Therefore, what gets measured is what gets done. So it governs consequences. Since what gets measured is what gets done, what gets measured then drives the particular type of performance that you have, good or bad, depending on what you're measuring. So basically, principles govern consequences. You are subject to the consequences regardless, again, of whether you believe in, understand, or whatever feelings you may have about a given principle, or even whether you're even aware of the principle. So there are some key points, though, that we need to keep in mind, which is the principles are interrelated. The amount of emphasis that you place on each principle and its timing often differ within any given organization. Again, we're going to look at 10 key principles in the Shingo model. Okay, so that is important. But for each of those principles, we need to have behavioral benchmarks, things to which we would compare actual behavior. So a behavior can be observed, it can be described, it can be recorded. What we're looking for is ideal behaviors. What are ideal behaviors? Ideal behaviors are actions that create outcomes that produce results that are excellent in and of themselves, but are also sustainable and can be improved over time. So that's what an ideal behavior is. What we want to be able to do inside the organization is look at actual behaviors and compare actual behaviors to ideal behaviors. But first we have to obviously be able to identify what ideal behaviors are, and that is oftentimes contextually driven. So that any examples that you see in this presentation are very generic, but generally speaking, they will be contextually specific to the enterprise that's being examined. So when you go through an assessment, we would have a worksheet like this for every one of its 10 principles. So this is one of the principles that you see sitting on the far left side of this particular worksheet, where it says respect every individual. So under respect every individual, we'd be looking at three key areas: support, recognition, and community, which we would define in specific ways. We would say, what are core ideal behaviors associated with each of these? What does that look like among leaders in the organization, among managers in the organization, and among associates, the people who get the vast majority of the actual work done? What are the systems that are in place that will either support, what are the systems that are in place that will either support or hinder accomplishment of those ideal behaviors? What are some key indicators or measures, if you will, of those behaviors? And what are the sorts of questions that you might ask as you go through the company to try to learn whether or not those behaviors are practiced, and if not those behaviors, then which ones are? And so again, we have organizational foundational purpose, we have assessment in that different colored blue down low. We talked about principles, we talked about behavioral benchmarks. We have to assess. We have to be able to assess what's going on in the organization. Well, what is assessment? It means different things to different people, but fundamentally it is very much like going to a doctor. When you go to visit a doctor, generally speaking, what you want to learn is, how are you doing? How do you get better? So there's a difference between how you're doing and where you want to be in the future, probably. So a gap analysis. We need to be able to learn from the doctor what the gap is and how to bridge that gap. That's one of the purposes behind assessment, which we will define here as the regular, rigorous, systematic, and systemic review of all of an enterprise's culture and all relevant strategies, behaviors, and results. We do that with purpose, with the purpose being continuously improving enterprise performance. We always do that by observing very carefully what's happening, taking careful notes. So we might be using a sheet like this. And we evaluate behavior using a scale, but our focus is centered on ideal behavior and then identifying also what the actual behavior is and comparing those. So this would be more or less what we have for assessment. Okay? We'd be taking assessment notes carefully. There's nothing magic about that 10 that you see here, the list of 10. We would be looking at each principle. This one is respect every individual. We would be breaking that up into different categories, and we would be evaluating how they're performing against particular statements, let's say. But we also have an overall assessment. So this might come from the Shingo Insight instrument. The Shingo Insight instrument is basically how do your people view for themselves what's going on inside the organization versus the more common assessment for the prize itself to see whether or not a company is prize worthy, which is an external assessment. It is a third party assessment where you have neutral assessors that are neutral and expert assessors who are coming in to compare the performance of the organization to the Shingo criteria and principles and so on. This one you see insight. That is literally the view from the inside, from the people at the organization about how the organization is doing. So they're two different views. We have a behavioral maturity scale, and this behavioral maturity scale, will apply to each of the 10 principles in the Shingo model. In terms of just presentation for example purposes, you see one of those principles listed on the side, or one of the categories rather, or dimensions of cultural enablers. But generally what we have is that observations are measured against key behavioral indicators using this particular maturity scale. It indicates to you that the scale has five different characteristics as it relates to behavior and comparison of actual to ideal. And those characteristics are frequency, intensity, duration, scope, and role. And the descriptions that you see indicate the top of each level. So the top of this level is barely matches key behavioral indicator. That's at 20%. Obviously at 0% it doesn't match at all. So at 20% barely matches the key behavioral indicator. At 40% it lightly matches. 60% somewhat matches. Level 4 mostly matches, 80%. And level 5 matches KBI completely or perfectly, that's 100%. Now what you see down below are some figures, and the figures indicate that 67.4%, that compared to historic values for companies that have applied for and have been acknowledged by the Shingo Institute, relative to the Shingo Prize criteria, that in that area you will find Shingo bronze medallion winners, very much like the bronze medal at the Olympics. In the next category, you see 67.5% to 77.4%. Companies that score at that level across the various dimensions and areas that are assessed tend to be recognized with the Shingo silver medallion, again, very much like a silver medal in the Olympics. And then those who score higher typically will be Shingo Prize Award winners. That's the big one. Very much like the gold medal at the Olympics. So what you'd have, for example, with cultural enablers is we'd be looking at particular systems. Those systems might include engagement, environmental health and safety, measurement and innovation, motivation, recognition, and you see the same scale that is setting here. So notice that this is designed only for training purposes, only for illustrative purposes, and that in fact these systems are not intended to be, by any means, a complete list. Some of those systems will be everywhere. There'll be other systems that are unique to a given enterprise, perhaps, and that you need to be able to identify. So if you're trying to get the maximum benefit from assessing your organization relative to the Shingo Prize principles and model, or for that matter, any other model, then here's what you want. Generally speaking, you want a third-party assessment. In other words, you want people who are not invested in the organization, either to its prosperity or to its failure. They are neutral. A third-party independent assessment. And part of that is it's this sort of idea that really you're not good enough to tell me your own reality. Because any time that you're involved in something, you lose sight of part of what's going on. So we need to avoid that. So a good third-party assessment raises different questions and identifies opportunities that if you're on the inside, you're not likely to see all the time. Assessment should focus on big gaps, not little things, but focus on the big gaps between actual and ideal. And additionally, that help prioritize what it is that you should be working on. So prioritization of the gaps uses a lot of different tools, and you should be doing that once those gaps have been identified. So you've seen principles, behavioral benchmarks, assessment. What comes next? And the answer is systems and strategy. So there are three insights of enterprise excellence that have been identified, three primary ones. The first is that ideal results require ideal behavior. Okay, that makes sense. But the question is, how do you produce those ideal behaviors? And part of the answer is that purpose and systems drive behaviors. Therefore, we need to have the right purpose and the right systems in place to produce those ideal behaviors to ultimately produce the ideal results that our customers and other stakeholders clamor for. And then the third insight is that principles inform those ideal behaviors. So what do you need to do? You need, in part, you're going to work across all levels of the organization in assessment, but to a large degree, you're going to be working at the highest level of the organization in an actual assessment. So what is a corporate strategy? Corporate strategy itself is a system. Does it drive behavior? Does the strategy drive behaviors? The obvious answer is that it should be yes. Is it principle-based? Is that strategy ideal? Or is there something better that would drive different behaviors? So a typical exercise that you might go through would be to ask yourself, what are the characteristics of a good system? And is there anything that is truly ideal as a system? Or can systems always be improved? And most people who are focused on improvement would say, yes, every system can be improved. We may not know how to do that right now, but generally speaking, every system can be improved. So systems are multidimensional. They have multiple aspects to them, and a positive impact in one area or relative to one aspect may not generate a positive outcome across the entire system, system-wide. In fact, it may work to the detriment of something else, and so we need to be able to think and act systemically to understand how that system comes together, how it fits, what are its component pieces, how they complement one another, and in some cases, how some components of the system may actually work in opposition to other parts of the system. So when we build systems, because we accomplish so much through systems, systems drive behaviors, behaviors lead to performance, then there are certain things that we should know. First is that building systems that drive behavior is a team effort, ordinarily speaking. It is not a one-person show. It is a big investment. Investment of emotion, investment of attitude, investment of time. Not necessarily money, but it's a big investment. There are often multiple systems that focus on the behavior that we're trying to modify. Systems are not mutually exclusive, there's overlap. The question is, which systems are complementary to one another and which ones work in opposition to one another? Obviously, if you're focused on aligning your organization to accomplish all that it can be, to do all it can do, to become all it can be, to produce the greatest possible performance for your stakeholders, then you will want to formulate your systems and deploy your system in ways where they actually complement one another and move in a given direction toward a stated end or a stated purpose, fulfillment of a stated purpose. And that's important, and that aspect is called enterprise alignment overall. Selection of an ideal system focused on the ideal behavior is an iterative process. You don't do it at the start and then that's it forever. We tend to learn as we go and improve as we go. A good system will indicate whether the key behavioral indicators that you're using are quote-unquote correct or even reasonable to use. And then the role of managers in general is to spend their time focused on identifying and promoting the correct behaviors, and hence you need the correct key behavioral indicators. So Shingo principles are implemented and practiced through the systems that you and your enterprise design and implement. What comes next? Well, what comes next are tools. And so what is a tool? A tool is a single device or item that accomplishes a specific task. That will then work in league, or they will come together in multiple tools to form systems. But the problem is that a lot of organizations focus at the tool level. Now, tools will take you somewhere. They will get you so far. They will help you make progress. But the thing is that they will not get you all the way to the promised land. To get to the promised land, you need some additional things. And that's part of what we're doing here, is trying to identify what those additional things are and determine how it is that we can advance with those. So we have those five, but we also need key behavioral indicators and key performance indicators. And together with those, we can hopefully cross from one side to the other, from just the blah organization to the excellent organization. Sometimes to know what it is that we should be working on, it helps to have something like this matrix, this impact effort matrix. So ideally, where you would love to be working most of the time is right here. This is in a place where you are producing high impact results, quick wins, with very low effort. We need high impact, generally speaking. But if it's big effort involved is usually focused on strategic intervention. Low impact results, it doesn't mean that you ignore them. Sometimes you have to have those low impact results. You have to get the small things right in order to accomplish the big things, so to speak. So low impact quick wins, they are low impact, but they're easy to implement. Opportunities will be considered third. So first are the high impact ones. Second are the low impact. Eventually, where you have deferred improvements, they have low impact, and they're going to take a lot of your time and effort to be able to accomplish them. Therefore, why focus on those if you have other better things to do? So now we need to prioritize. That's part of that impact effort matrix. But finally, we have to produce results. That's the reason that the organization exists, is to provide results of whatever sort are attractive to the stakeholder segments that the organization is trying to serve. Oftentimes we'd say the customer, if we want to be just highly generic. So that gets you to the Shingo 10 principles that appear like this. Those 10 principles are divided into four dimensions: the blue dimension, the rust color dimension, the yellow dimension, and the green dimension. So the blue dimension, the cultural enablers, lead with humility and respect every individual. The five continuous improvement principles inside the continuous improvement dimension would be flow and pull value, assure quality at the source, focus on process, embrace scientific thinking, seek perfection. Inside enterprise alignment, it's create constancy of purpose and think systemically. I would normally say not create constancy of purpose. I would normally say create unity of purpose and shared vision. And in results, I would say rather than create value for the customer, think more broadly, create value for stakeholders. Though, of course, customers could be your principal or most important stakeholder. So those are the 10 principles. Those things have been discussed in the prior four presentations and videos that I mentioned earlier on in this presentation. But results and systems are interconnected. Notice that you have key performance indicators that rest on top. That is mostly in the green category, the results category. But the things in the yellow, rust, and blue categories, those are primarily key behavioral indicators that we need to be looking at carefully. Okay. So what are ideal results? They're actions that are aligned, they are excellent, they are sustainable, and they demonstrate improvement over time. And that's what we're trying to provide or to yield through all of our effort would be ideal results, doing so through ideal behaviors. What does a typical transformation timeline look like? What milestones will enable you to see if you're winning or losing? That's the basic question. At any given day, are you winning or are you losing? Did you win the day or did you lose the day? And that's the question you should be trying to answer day upon day upon day, brick upon brick upon brick. Are you winning or are you losing? And what are those key things that you need to be able to examine to tell whether you're winning or losing? What does your Build Excellence Roadmap look like? How do you maintain and sustain any progress that you've made? We would normally call that just holding the gain. How do we get better and better and better? What is the role of leaders and managers in terms of maintaining momentum, improvement momentum? What are the roles? What are the responsibilities? Are the people in the right roles? Are they assigned the right responsibilities? So we need to talk about agreement for meeting and tracking process, governance systems. These are the sorts of things that we need to be asking about and seeing what's happening. So a lot of times what we look for is creating improved performance progress. And this comes from Cotter. Cotter had 8 steps. You'll see a different expression of these 8 steps on the next slide. But basically, step one is, in terms of instituting change, this is Cotter's change model, is create a sense of urgency. Once you've done that, build a guiding coalition. Then form a strategic vision and initiatives. Enlist a volunteer army to execute this. Enable action by removing barriers to action. Make sure that you resource people appropriately to be able to accomplish this. 6, generate short-term wins, because without short-term wins, oftentimes interest wanes. And any momentum that you build goes away, and your probability of longer-term success becomes dramatically lower. Hence, we need to generate short-term wins, and then speed up, speed up, speed up, sustain acceleration. And finally, institute change on a more permanent basis. So oftentimes you see this portrayed as a stair step. This is the short description of each of the stairs in the staircase. Increase urgency, build guiding teams, get the vision right, communication for buy-in, enable action, create short-term wins, don't let up, make sure it sticks, hold the gain. And some of the questions that you should be asking yourself as you go through this assessment is, do we need to revise the strategic plan? Is it consistent with what we learned? Okay. If we learned something else, then maybe changes need to be made. Do we have an executable plan for building excellence? Yes, we want to know how healthy we are. Yes, we want to know what healthier looks like. But we have to have an actual strategy for bridging that gap from how healthy we are to how healthy we want to be in the future. So do you have an executable plan for building excellence? Can we show our executives the linkages between behaviors and results? Are the recommended improvements self-funded, which is often regarded as important in lean applications? And are we ready to complete a plan for building excellence across all behavioral benchmarks? So as you go through an enterprise assessment against the Shingo model, ordinarily speaking, you're going to be talking about each of the four Shingo dimensions. So the cultural enablers dimension, the continuous improvement dimension, the enterprise alignment dimension, and the results dimension, each of which has some number of principles that are going to be addressed. Cultural enablers has two principles, continuous improvement, five, enterprise alignment, two, results, just one. Okay. But the questions that you ask are going to go deeper and deeper and deeper to the heart of the problem. So you're going to have principle-focused questions, system-focused questions, and tool-focused questions. When you go through the assessment, when you go to the Gemba, you go and see the place where the work is actually done, you observe, you do that with big eyes, that is, be very observant. You do that with big ears, listen carefully. You do that with a small mouth. Seek first to understand and then to be understood. So your mouth predominantly, while you're going to the Gemba, should be to ask appropriate questions where, going back to the preceding slide, these are what we're talking about. So what systems did you see in place? What evidence did you actually see? Hard evidence, not a guess, not an assumption. What hard evidence did you see? What level was the behavior associated with these systems? That is, was it barely matching ideal behaviors? What was happening? What are my recommendations? What are the key strengths that I saw, and also obviously the key weaknesses? What's your plan? What are the opportunities to move up to the next level? So the focus is on asking questions. Don't bury your head in your nose. Ask questions. Learn. Using sheets like these. So you should say, what does an ideal behavior look like? And you're going to try and describe that in words. Okay? It isn't like we often say about quality. I'll know it when I see it. We don't wait until we see it. We try to describe it in advance so that we are able to see the difference between what we actually see and what the ideal should look like. Now, we may revise what ideal looks like later, but we should have a concept of what ideal looks like going in. Ideal relative to each principle. What behavior did you actually see? Here's the ideal, here's the actual. If there's a gap, describe the gap. You may not be able to quantify the gap with some number, but you can probably qualify the gap descriptively. Ideal behavior and actual behavior. What systems work, or what work systems might you see? What behavior does the system drive? Because remember, systems drive behaviors. What questions can you ask to get started? It's a good idea to have some of these things in place before you go in. What questions can I ask, for example? So the degree to which observed behavior matches an ideal behavior, that's what we're looking for. These are the five levels right here. Barely matches, lightly matches, somewhat matches, mostly matches, matches. So the deeper your understanding of principles, the better your ability is to define and recognize ideal behaviors and observe the difference between what's ideal and what's actually happening. That is, the gap. So you might go into this with just post-it notes helping you. So you're going to be looking at each principle. So you might have, just on yellow post-it notes, a blank sheet like this. You might have this up on a white erase board or something like that even. But then put up some post-it notes. What are the behavioral benchmarks I'm looking at? What level were we at? So in cultural enablers, we'd be looking in the area of people development, for example. There's a system, people development. How is it that this enterprise practices development of its people? And we would need to have key behavioral indicators that we derive that are contextually driven. And again, we have those three levels. These are just crude guidelines that you're going to see pop out in these balloons at the bottom. That generally speaking, scoring at that level across all of the principles in the entire assessment would yield a bronze medallion. that level of silver medallion, and the upper level, although it's behind the camera that's focused on me, would be the Shingo Prize level, Shingo Prize worthy level of performance. But remember that to a large degree, you're assessing culture. What is culture? It's the way we think, the way we act, the way we interact. Oftentimes, I summarize that by just saying, it's the way we do things around here. It's how we think, it's how we act, it's how we interact with one another. So you're going to try to identify behavioral benchmarks. Identify three ideal behaviors. Try to identify three ideal behaviors for each benchmark. Three because you want one for the leader level, one for the management level, one for the associate level. By leaders, we're usually talking about senior executive leadership. Management, we're usually talking about middle management. And associates are the people who do the vast majority of the work. So what are some learning objectives here? Understand the Shingo model and its various dimensions. It's four dimensions. Strengthen your understanding of the relationship among behavior systems and principles. Learn how systems and behaviors drive results. Understand behavioral benchmarks behind all the dimensions. And lastly, if you had the opportunity, would be to go out on the floor, out to the plant floor, inside the enterprise, and actually observe what's going on. Go and observe, also called go to the gemba. So let's start with the cultural enablers dimension. And in the cultural enablers dimension, there are two principles. The first is respect every individual. So what are some behavioral benchmarks behind respecting every individual? So I won't go into reading the description of each because there are going to be a lot of these the rest of the way in this presentation. 1.1, because we're calling it the first principle. Support, recognize, or recognition, and community. Now, I pointed out that we call it the first principle. I do not have, throughout this presentation, these in the same order as the Shingo Prize. I have them in an order that makes more sense to me. Okay, but that's all it is one that makes more sense to me. Regardless, you're going to have to assess each of these. So behavioral benchmarks for that principle of respect every individual inside the cultural enablers category. Support. We invest in everyone's development and encourage them to realize their potential. Recognition. We honor contributions of every employee. Notice these are, in fact, behaviors. Community. Our organization ensures a physical and emotional safe workplace, and we're a good steward of the environment. So we would have a worksheet like this, where we have the principal setting off to the far left on the side, respect every individual. We have behavioral benchmarks, which we've just used the one-word descriptions right here, but you've identified those and defined those on the prior page. Those are the behavioral benchmarks, but now you still have to identify the ideal behaviors for each of those. Probably three for each of those. One at the leadership level, one at the manager level, one at the associate levels. What are the systems in place? How will you actually measure your key behavioral indicators? What are some of the questions you would ask? So notice that this is aligned with what I've said, that for each of those categories, those behavioral benchmarks, support, recognition, and community, you would be looking for ideal behaviors associated with those from leaders, ideal behaviors from managers, ideal behaviors from associates. That's what the L, the M, and the A on this slide and on subsequent ones will be associated with as leader, management, or managers, and associates. What about the second principle? The second principle is assess, lead with humility. The second Shingo principle, lead with humility inside the cultural enablers dimension. So let's look at a quick video on leading with humility.
When I look at the Shingo guiding principle of leading with humility, I'm reminded of the fact that respect doesn't automatically come with a leadership position. You have to earn it. And to me, gaining respect is like slowly filling a bucket from a dripping tap. It'll take a long, long time to fill, but unfortunately, all it takes is one small instance or a stupid remark and it's all gone. The key to building trust is having the self-awareness and humility to understand that you can learn from everybody in the organisation, particularly from those on the front line who are the real expert and possess the tacit knowledge about your products and your processes that are not to be found in any procedures or policies. Leading with humility requires leaders to not only know their own personal weaknesses, but also to have the courage to share them with others so that they can help them cover what are essentially their blind spots. It is being humble that protects leaders from developing an ego, which is undoubtedly the greatest barrier to learning and becoming not only a better leader, but also a better person. At Lake Region Medical, our senior management team follow the Shingo principle of leading with humility through their attendance at the daily Gemba meetings which take place throughout the plant. At these meetings, leaders get to hear and see at first hand the critical issues concerning our people and, most importantly, the obligation on leadership to provide support and direction. After all, that's what leadership is all about.
Be more conscious about what is happening around with the associates or the people that is working with me. It makes me be more proactive to listen to people, to look different ways how to work together and how to fix the problem as a team.
So for a new leader or even a seasoned or veteran leader, leading with humility requires a lot of vulnerability. It allows a leader to come into an organization and really expose themselves to create a transparency in the environment that allows people to bring up problems without fear of consequence. And that's really what the leading with humility really is for a leader.
When I think about lead with humility, I'm reminded that humility, to really understand what humility is in the Shingo model, requires the recognition that there's something to learn from everyone at every level and every role in an organization. And secondly, it's the recognition that in order to achieve goals that might be important to me or to my leadership, all of us are interdependent. All of us must work together in order to achieve the goals we have. To me, that helps understand what Lead with Humility is all about. It's that recognition that we all need each other.
So what are the behavioral benchmarks associated with Lead with Humility? Servant leadership, courage, and empowerment. So remember, we're looking for about three behavioral benchmarks, and then we're looking for three ideal behaviors associated with each of those benchmarks, one for leaders, one for managers, one for associates. So again, you can read as easily as I can read for you the longer elaborations of what we mean by servant leadership, by courage, and by empowerment. But I would say, normally speaking, that empowerment in an organization, there's a business purpose or a business case behind empowerment. And the business case behind empowerment, ordinarily speaking, is to put the solution to the customer's problem or the stakeholder's problem, put the solution as close to the customer as possible so that in as near to real time as possible, their problem can be solved, it can be remedied. So we're not empowering people just because we're nice. We're empowering people because it makes sense from a business perspective for the health of the organization to serve its customers well, but also we create healthier work environment internally when we empower our people. Now, I would say, generally speaking, that empowerment is not real unless people are properly trained, they are properly equipped, they have forgiveness for honest mistakes, at least to a point, and also that they are held reasonably accountable. And there's a fine line between, and that balance between accountability and forgiveness. But nevertheless, if there's not forgiveness for honest mistakes, they were never empowered in the first place. In fact, if there's not forgiveness for honest mistakes, generally speaking, people are not going to be as forthright as they would be with their improvements for suggestion and their improvements in general, because they know that criticism can lead to punishment. So the worksheet would look very much as it did for respect every individual. Here it is, lead with humility. Behavioral benchmarks, 3, one for servant leadership, servant leadership, courage, and empowerment, each of which you would identify 3 core ideal behaviors. Look for systems, determine the key behavioral indicators or measures that would help you with that, and identify the potential questions you're going to be asking when you're out there truly assessing enterprise performance. So you see again, leaders, managers, and associates in each area for each behavioral benchmark. What are ideal behaviors for leaders relative to servant leadership? What are our ideal behaviors for managers relative to servant leadership? What are ideal behaviors for associates relative to servant leadership? And so on. So relative to cultural enablers, generally some of the systems that you would see, right? Let's go back. We had behavioral benchmarks. We're looking for core ideal behaviors. You're looking for systems. And that's the second slide after this one, looking for systems. So what are the systems? Engagement, environmental health, safety, and society, measurement, motivation, recognition, and so on. Let's move on to the continuous improvement dimension of the Shingo Operational Excellence Model. So you just saw the two principles of the Shingo model that reside in the cultural enablers category, lead with humility, respect every individual. Now you're going to see 5 in the continuous improvement category. And the one that we're going to look at first will be critical and scientific thinking. Now, this is out of order from the way that's ordinarily presented inside a Shingo assessment, but I believe that it's critical to have it here. So that would be their 4th one. I'm listing it here actually as the 3rd in my order. It doesn't really matter. So what would be some behavioral benchmarks for embracing scientific and critical thinking? Reflection, analysis, and collaboration. Now, I should point out that I'm saying embrace scientific and critical thinking. In Shingo language, they would simply say embrace scientific thinking. But scientific and critical thinking are somewhat different, hence I use both words. They're very much like perception and cognition in psychology. Perception is that you see something is happening. Cognition is that you understand and work toward understanding of whatever it is. Change you've seen relative to whatever it is that you implemented. So scientific thinking is experimentalism. Critical thinking is trying to understand the results of the change that was made through scientific thinking and scientific action. So we reflect, we analyze, we collaborate. 3 behavioral benchmarks with descriptions more extensively here. Obviously, you can pause this presentation anytime you want if you want to be taking notes on the fuller descriptions of reflection, analyze, collaborate, and so on. But we do the same thing in terms of a worksheet. Over on the left side, you see the principle, you see behavioral benchmarks. For each benchmark, we'd look for 3 ideal behaviors, 1 for leaders, 1 for managers, 1 for associates. We would do something similar with regard to a second continuous improvement principle, focus on processes. So what would be the behavioral benchmarks for focus on process? These: understand, design, attribution. Again, feel free to pause the video to write down the descriptions of these more fully. Understand, design, attribution. So you see again from a worksheet, you see that you have the principle that's residing on the far left, and you see the 3 behavioral benchmarks. Look for the same thing, ideal behaviors. What do those look like for each of those behavioral benchmarks? What do they look like from a leadership perspective? What are ideal behaviors at the manager level? What are ideal behaviors at the associate level? Still a third continuous improvement principle would be assure quality at the source. The idea behind which is never knowingly pass along a flaw or a defect or an error to the next person or next process in line. Never knowingly pass along anything with shortcomings. So what are some of the behavioral benchmarks you might have? Mistake proofing. The Shingo Institute is named after Shigeo Shingo, who was one of the two co-developers of the Toyota production system, the other one being Taichi Ono. But Dr. Shingo, he received an honorary doctorate from Utah State University in the late 80s. Dr. Shingo approved the Shingo Prize, being named after him. He approved the name of the Shingo Institute. His son, Ritsuo, is still deeply engaged with the Shingo Institute. But Dr. Shingo, Shigeo Shingo, popularized and developed something called Pokeyoki, the English translation for which is essentially mistake proofing. So that would be one of the behavioral benchmarks that resides in assure quality at the source. Mistake proofing, ownership, connectedness. Again, principle to the far left of the worksheet, the behavioral benchmarks, and the rest you have to fill in. The rest is contextually driven. So there it is. This is what we always do. We always have the maturity scale. We're always going to be assessing. We're always going to be saying, where do you reside? Which category are you in? We would oftentimes try and be a little more detailed and say, 28%. Or we would physically position somewhere along a continuous scale, or a post-it note, or a mark of some sort that would indicate where we think they are within a given level. So assuring quality at the source, there you go. There's the worksheet. Here it is again, assuring quality at the source. Assuring quality at the source, what are the behavioral benchmarks? Transparency, ownership, and connectedness, as we talked about a minute ago, or mistake proofing. Assessing flow and pull of value, another continuous improvement principle, flow and pull value. What do we mean by that? We mean that in so far as possible, that we only produce according to actual demand, not anticipated demand, not wished for demand or whimsical thinking, but actual demand. And if you produce according only to actual demand, then you're trying to go for what is thought by many to be the ideal flow of production, which is one piece flow, one thing at a time. Now, that's an ideal. Companies don't usually get there, but the idea is to approach that as closely as you can. There are obviously occasions where that isn't necessarily the best thing. So as I'm taping this right now, we are in the midst of the COVID-19 pandemic. Everyone at this point knows that there were extreme shortages of ventilators, of masks, of test kits, and so on. So this particular circumstance is one where having inventory, in fact, having a lot of inventory, would have been a good thing. But more generally speaking, that isn't the best way to proceed. We don't proceed, generally speaking, with a just-in-case approach. Instead, we try to proceed with a just-in-time approach. What are some behavioral benchmarks behind flow and pull value? An uninterrupted flow, that we produce only according to actual demand, that we eliminate waste in every way that we can. So those would be the behavioral benchmarks. And again, don't pay so much attention to the numbering on the side. Pay attention to the fact that these are associated with flow and pull. So here you go, flow and pull. There's the worksheet, uninterrupted demand and elimination of waste. Notice this says 6, where I had 7s. Again, don't pay much attention to the numbers. The difference is in the order that I would ordinarily look versus the order that within the Shingo Institute they tend to look. Some of the numbering ordering is arbitrary. What about pursuit of perfection? So in the Shingo model, it's usually called seek perfection as a principle. But the actual idea is not seek perfection. Even the internal discussions in the Shingo Institute is not seek perfection. What it is about chase down excellence, pursue excellence with great vigor and enthusiasm. That's what you're trying to do. So in seeking perfection, what are some behavioral benchmarks? These two, mindset and structure. You need to challenge the paradigms and expectations that you hold. You need to approach improvement in a structured way, not a haphazard way. So you're doing it very systematically, so to speak, as you pursue perfection. So two behavioral benchmarks, and again, you would have to look for what are ideal behaviors associated with those and so on. So similar sort of organization. We would move on. We've now proceeded through cultural enablers. We've proceeded through continuous improvement and its five principles. And now we'd be looking at the dimension of assessing enterprise alignment. And remember that there were two principles that are associated with that. One of which is systemic thinking, think systemically. The other of which was basically institute constancy of purpose, or create constancy of purpose. So relative to think systemically, we would say as behavioral benchmarks, investigate perspective and linkage. And again, I recommend just pausing the video for a moment and writing down the broader description, the fuller description of each one of these things. Investigate. You engage in necessary conversations required to reveal the relationships and likely or interrelationships and likely outcomes. Perspective. You organize yourself to ensure a sufficiently diverse perspective to allow for informed actions, choices, and behaviors. Linkage. We ensure clear and direct connection between system objectives and outcomes. Let me visit perspective for just a moment. In the mid-1990s, there were two consecutive years where, in total, IBM lost about $12 billion. Big blue. $12 billion is a lot of money. It's a lot of money now. It was a lot more money then. So when they explored what are the roots of why we're losing so much, what can we do to change this? Fundamentally, what they found is that they lacked perspective, in a sense. They were big blue. They were monolithic. They dressed alike. They thought alike. They were trained alike. So one of their solutions to that, by the way, was to become intentionally more diverse. To hire people from different disciplines, from different cultures, from different ethnicities, and so on and so forth, to intentionally diversify to bring more diverse thoughts and ideas to the table. So in that sense, they diversified themselves out of the problems that they were in. They became intentionally more diverse by intentionally broadening their perspectives. Similar sort of worksheet. Principle on the extreme left, behavioral benchmarks there, and you'd want to assess at the leader, the manager, and the associate levels, just like you see portrayed on this particular slide. Also, enterprise alignment, constancy of purpose. Create constancy of purpose. Now, remember that there's the Deming view of that. There's a little bit different view on the Shingo Institute. The view relative to the Shingo Prize and the principle of create constancy of purpose is that you want basically to create unity of purpose. You may never get everybody in the organization on board behind the purpose, but you do need to get a critical mass. So unity of purpose and buy-in to a shared vision. So that's what we're looking for to help drive results. The behavioral benchmarks associated with that, alignment, elevation, communication. Please pause the presentation and write down those descriptions for yourself or take a screenshot or something like that. But this is what we're looking for, a common sense of purpose, unity of purpose, to drive all your decisions. If you're not moving to fulfillment of purpose, then the question is, what is it you're doing? It's the idea of being divided in heart and mind if you don't have unity of purpose. Similar worksheet. And hence you're looking for each behavioral benchmark, again, for three ideal behaviors at least, one from leaders, one from managers, one from associates. It's not that you couldn't have more for each of leaders, managers, and associates, but you want at least one ideal behavior from leaders or of leaders relative to alignment. But two is okay too. Three is better. And then lastly, we get to the results category, and it really isn't enough to create value. You have to interpret value for your prospects and customers so that they can feel the value emotionally and empirically. That is what we're after. It isn't just about money. A lot of people value things other than money, other than profit. They value an experience. They value a feeling of security. They value a lot of different things. So when we say create value for customers, the 10th principle in the Shingo model associated with results dimension, or as I would say, create value for stakeholders, remember that value can have very many dimensions. It isn't only about money. It may be about something distinctly different under certain circumstances and for certain stakeholders. So you're now in the results category, the category that says create value for the customer, or create value for stakeholders. So your behavioral benchmarks in this category would be relationships, integrate, value stream. Pause the video, take a screen capture, write down the description, whatever it is you need to do, but get an idea about what these are. Worksheet looks the same. You need to be able to assess. So once again, you're going to be looking at these benchmarks and identifying ideal behaviors for each. And then finally, you get to, as a reminder, wrapping almost everything up. What's the Shingo model? What are the guiding principles? You should have walked into the assessment itself, having this stuff burned into your brain. The essential things we have, the Shingo model. At the heart of the model is enterprise culture. Culture is driven by guiding principles. An enterprise may have any number of guiding principles, but if they're pursuing excellence as they would if they are adherent to the Shingo model criteria, or Shingo Operational Excellence Model criteria, then these would be 10 of their guiding principles. They may have additional ones. They probably have additional ones that may be contextual. They may say, we will deal with everyone honestly. We will deal with everyone with great transparency. We will, guiding principles. So we have the organizational culture at its heart of the model. Culture is built on guiding principles. It is there to produce results, or the enterprise is there to produce results for key stakeholders that they've identified. And those results are generally produced through tools and systems that lead to specific behaviors. We can see inside the larger pyramid the two principles in the cultural enablers dimension, the five principles in the continuous improvement dimension, the two in the enterprise alignment dimension, and lastly the results dimension and its one principle of create value for stakeholders. All of this led to three deep insights of enterprise excellence. And those three deep insights were that ideal results require ideal behaviors. Purpose and systems drive those ideal behaviors, or for that matter, poor behaviors as well. And principles inform ideal behaviors. You need both key performance indicators, which are very familiar in virtually every organization, but far less familiar are key behavioral indicators, KBIs. They're critical. The Shingo Operational Excellence Model, as you've seen. And lastly, that's it. That is a very fast surface level exploration of enterprise assessment relative to assessment of enterprise performance against the Shingo Model and its 10 principles. So I hope you've enjoyed this. Please feel free to chase me down. Again, my name is Rick Edgeman. I'm professor and chair of the management department at Fort Hays State University in Kansas. Thanks very much.